Let me start by firstly welcoming you. Fantastic to connect with, again, this wonderful organization of yours and the wonderful people that I've interacted with for so many years. And I found it being really focused on developing its leaders. And also at the same time, the leaders and participants, all of them also give back in a very big way back. All the accountability that they take is in a very big way giving back to the organization. So welcome here. And again, I want to mention it. This will be recorded so people can see it later. Let us understand as to how we can build a women leaders pipeline. So before we do that, I will like you to reflect on this question. What do countries with the best coronavirus responses have in common? In fact, I'll take a little poll from you. And I'll ask you to just reply what you think is the right answer. So on the screen, you will have a poll where you have option 1, 2, and 3. You can just select whichever element you think is the right one. So there are options available with you. Just lovely. I see some people already clicking in this. Fantastic. Great. So just kind of take any option. Again, I don't know who's going to take which option, so don't worry. Nobody will get to know whether your option is right or wrong. So it's just kind of getting to know the sense of what we believe is happening in the world around us. Right? Because whatever we do, we must be connected to the real world also. We can't be living in a cocoon where we get disconnected to the world. So yeah, great. So some of the great answers I'm getting, fantastic, fantastic. And for the people who have written others, can you then type it on the chat box? What do you think that others is? Because I find a lot of you saying others. Option 2, great, good leadership. Yeah, great. Fantastic. So some of you who have written others, so let me share this with you. Let me share the results of you. 50% of you believe it is other reasons. And 50% of you believe it is good medical infrastructure. So great. And what you believe in terms of other reasons are proactiveness, good leadership, you're not being able to see options. Okay, never mind. But can you see the results now? So this is the results. So let me take out the cat from the bag and tell you what it is. And the answer may surprise most of us. In each of these countries which have done the best, each of this country today has a women leader, be it Iceland, Taiwan, Germany, New Zealand, Finland, Iceland and Denmark. The women leaders of today are truly teaching the world a new way of leadership. And they are rightly telling us that women seem to be and will be leaders of the 21st century, and nobody can take it away from them. So the good news for all of us is that women leaders are a critical need for 21st century organization, and it is not the other way around. It is not the requirement of women to become leaders. It is more a requirement of the organization developing leaders to become leaders or women to become leaders. And as they do so, our research has found, and the research on the right is a white paper that we created, based with our interaction with Leadership Global. So we did research on a large number of competencies that are required for this 21st century. And we found, in conjunction with what we saw, so the blog has just come in. This white paper we wrote maybe a year and a half back. And the great news is, what we foresaw as a great element that we could tap into is truly showing up in the world today. So women today are critical for 21st century organizations to grow and sustain themselves. Having said that, let's not try to find, if women really are the need of the hour, what kind of leaders do we really need in the 21st century? So we are not trying to force fit women. We are first trying to find out what is the leadership required? And then we'll tap into what is the leadership of women bringing to the fore, which men leadership cannot. And how can this women leadership in a collaborative way, support the men leadership so that both elements, or maybe multiple perspectives, are tapped into the perspectives of the men, perspectives of the women, and the strengths of both of them are combined to give greater leadership to organization. Thank you, Vinita. Great. So what kind of leadership do we need in the 21st century? See, the business of the 20th century is changing, and like how? Every single day, we find new things coming up, which companies in the 20th century never saw. So the business environment is hugely changing. And based on this huge change that is happening, the alpha male, competitive type of leadership which men brought to the fore in the 20th century, and let me tell you, it was successful then, is no more successful today. That's the sad part of it. Or maybe the good part of it. So today, fundamentals of business practices are changing, and they're moving from something known as a competitive methodology to a more collaborative methodology. So this change that we are finding, hence, needs leaders who are able to rapidly change based on the changing environment. And for that, they need agility and adaptability. Also today, since the world has become so complex, no single person in any organization, and why organization, even a single person, in every team alone cannot do it all. So what we need is collaboration with people to be agile and be able to change with times at a very, very fast, rapid pace. So with that need that we have identified, we find that the new business leaders, other than harnessing globalization, other than harnessing technology, also need to harness the new societal norms and attitudes. And they are new now because they are on ethics. And I would say that they are the old new, because they were always there. We somehow forgot about them in the 20th century, where everything was fair in love and war, and business was taken as war. So now there's a new ethical code which is coming in, which talks about fairness, which talks about collective involvement of people, and which talks about collaboration. So this is the need of the hour. Let us see, what does the new leader need to be able to do? The first thing this new leader needs to do is build collaborative relationships. He needs to reach out to people, get into dialogic conversations, and build collaborative relationships, because alone, even if he wants so, he cannot or does not have the capacity to do it all alone. They also need to be radical in the thinking, mean creative. They need to come out with ideas which are radical, which have not been done before. And for any radical and creative idea to come up on fore, you need multiple specialities and multiple mindsets to interact with each other, because a new idea will always come when two or four, three or four distinct pieces which did not seem to connect before are suddenly made to connect. And as they are made to connect, this new connection that has taken place brings out a new connect or new idea. A case in point that comes to my mind is Mahatma Gandhi. He brought out a new idea. The new idea was radical thinking, was non-violent protest. Now, if you see, non-violence is in this end of the spectrum. Protest is in this end of the spectrum. When two distinct ideas which did not seem to have a connection before made a connection and led to a new thought and a new implementation of the thought, suddenly you found, all of a sudden you found that people were able to get new ideas. And that was the great part of this entire story. Also, what these leaders were able to do, they were able to think beyond the ego, operate beyond the ego. They did not, or they, these leaders do not need to believe, I know it all. No, that's not what they need to do. They don't need to know that when somebody comes to me, I am the one who has to give all the answers. So And most of the answers that we give when somebody comes to us is based on our ego, that somebody came to me, now I have to reply because I'm the manager, because I'm the specialist, because I'm the senior. So these people have to operate beyond the ego. And when you start operating beyond the ego, you become vulnerable. And very interestingly, vulnerability is today one of the greatest competencies leaders must have. Leaders must have the capability to say, I don't know. Also, leaders in this present era should be able to say, while I don't know, let us all get together and have a discussion and think about this new problem, this wicked problem that we have got, and let us try to see it from various perspectives of sales and marketing, various perspective of operations, various perspective of supply chain management, various perspectives of finance. And as we are able to see this problem and not believe that it is only one way of looking at it, you shed your ego and you are able to then find a solution. So this new leader that there is a need of today needs to be able to go beyond his ego. And also this leader must know that if he wants to continue to be an effective leader, he needs to invest time in his own personal development and growth. So what got him here won't get him there is something that he needs to know. And he needs to know that as the world changes, I also need to change and develop myself. So with that in mind, the outcome that this new leader needed to bring or needs to bring to fore for an organization, he needs to build within himself authentic, ethical, and emotional intelligent behaviors. This leader also needs to create strong, empathetic, and collaborative relationships. And this leader also needs to create an organization that is performance enhancing in its culture, not performance, not high performance, but performance enhancing. What is the difference between high performance and performance enhancing? Anybody? You can just type on the chat box. What do you think is the difference between high performance organization and performance enhancing organization? Just type, yeah. Thank you so much. Somebody's typing. Yeah. Focusing, beautiful. Focusing on continuous improvement. That is what it is. Absolutely. Improving is enriching, right? Enhancing it. So, in fact, the Maslow triangle that there was, right? Maslow hierarchy of needs. It had something on the top which says self-actualization. But before he died, he put up another element in front of it, ahead of it. He says, self-actualization is not what we are looking for. We are looking for self-transcendence. So we are self-transcending ourselves. Because self-actualization is achieving something and say, I have actualized it. He said, no, there's never going to be a self-actualization ever. There's always going to be a self-actualization, but we need to get better. So we have to transcend where we are today. So that is what culture would do. Wherever you are is the new norm. Unfortunately, right? But now we need to get better, improve ourselves to get to the next level. Kind of outcome this new leader needs to play. So this leader is a leader whom we call as transpersonal leader, beyond himself. He's a person who leads beyond his ego, transpersonal, beyond himself. Now, this is the kind of leader that we need for this 21st century. If that is established and if we agree with this, let us understand what relevance does this have to the topic of today. Why have we identified the needs of the present day leader? And why are we talking about him even before we are talking about women leadership? Now, the reason why we are doing it, because we don't want to force fit. I don't want to force fit women leaders into a position to say, because they are women, because diversity is what we need to look after, they need to get a position somewhere. Please put a quota for them. That is not enabling. That is actually disabling. Because the today fact of life is that in various studies done across the world, it could be a global study done by Mercer, where he talks about when women thrive. It could be our own study which we have conducted. We have found that more and more companies today need the leadership qualities that women bring to fore. Not because the women needs to be made leaders, because there is a critical need for this kind of competencies and mindsets to find a place in every level of leadership and management that there is. So again, I said, nobody is doing women a favor. The women, what they bring to the fore, is exactly what is needed in this 21st century, because the business environment has changed. And luckily for us, we have a gender available with us who normally and naturally have these competencies which men seem to, some elements of it, some elements of these competencies men don't seem to be good at. So that's the reason why we want women here. Also, it has been found that companies which had more women percentage in boards were companies which did better. Now, what we have found is, in the US, there are 19.9% of women in boards. And when we are talking about boards, we are only talking about the S&P 500, the top 500 companies of the US. Also, we found in UK, this is UK here, in the FTSE 250, the top 250 companies in the USA, there were 19.6% of women in that. What we also found in Norway, they were close to 40% of women in those boards. However, we have a long way to go in India, since we are only 7.7%. Much, much lesser than the global percentage of 12%. So while it's a great input that we have, there's a long way to go yet. And we need to support women leaders to grow and get better so that they reclaim or they claim their true look at leadership. So with that in mind, let us find out who's to be blamed for it. Who is it to be blamed? As to why women, so is it the men? So I'm taking a little survey again. Is it all because of the men? Yes or no? Is it this cruel man who is stopping women to come up? Or is it partially true? I don't know. So some of them says yes, some yes, yes, yes. Yeah. It's all about the other person. So just kind of click on any of the options. And then I'll share the results with you. Another 3 seconds. Yeah, great. Lovely. So some of you who says no, please type on the chat box if it is not because of the men. Who else could be a party to this? Who else could be a party? Yeah, great. So that's a great revelation. And let me now share the poll results with you. Here I'm sharing it. The beautiful part is 90.9% of the women believe, the women who are here, saying it is big because of both. They have a part to play, but we also have a part to play. And this clearly shows one element that women are better than men, that is self-awareness. The women are better in self-awareness. And thank you so much for all of you. It is partly because of men, but let's not only blame the others. Let us also take our due responsibility and be accountable for it. The acceptance of legacy, absolutely. So what we find is that in the world today, we do have some great men who understand the values that women bring to the fore, and these men have understood that women can play a very important part in leadership roles. And these men are the men that you should, or men that you should find as mentors. There are a lot of men in the world today who believe in this. In fact, when I was in the Indian Army and I was commanding my regiment, and I had 22 officers, and you know, when the general would come, I would line them up on a straight line, and I would introduce them to the general. And when I would come to the 12th person, so I had two lady officers with me. The 12th person was a lady officer, and whenever I introduced that lady officer to any visiting VIP, I openly said, this is so and so, she is the best officer that I have. So a lot of people like me who have gone through the rigors of life understand that what women bring to the fore is of great value because it brings perspectives that men naturally cannot see. Having said that, there are also some men, and that's what Lena said, acceptance of legacy, who do not want their own bubble to be busted. They even now believe that the alpha male kind of methodology of doing it with competition, doing it with power, is all that it takes to be successful in life. So we do have people like this too. But having said that, there's another element, and all of you brought that out, who also needs to take accountability to this. And that is women themselves. Now, what we found in the assessments that we did, we found two elements that was preventing women to take their rightful place. The first was self-confidence. The second was emotional self-control. So out of few things, these were two things that we found. Stopped women from taking their rightful place under the sun. And this is something that needs to be ensured that we start developing. So it seems to be a real issue that women will naturally undermine their own achievements, are afraid of being found out, and suffer from the imposter syndrome. So if that is true, let us also get to know how was this research conducted so that we get to know the reality of it. Let's start believing in this result, right? That's why I put it here. So what we did was, we started asking about these women from people who were around them, with whom they had meaningful and continuous relationships. So they were the individuals themselves. So they did a self-assessment. They were their managers. They were their peers. They were their reports. And there were others around them who were interacting with them. So we started getting anonymous inputs from them. In this anonymous inputs, we asked them about the women and how they were doing in these 19 competencies. So three competencies under self-awareness, six competencies under self-management, three competencies under social awareness, and seven competencies under relationship management. So it was against this we started getting inputs. And what we found was that when we were able to get inputs, we asked them inputs under, let's say, conflict management, we had 92, total of 92 granular behaviors. We said, what is the behavior you see the women demonstrating? And what is the ideal behavior you like to see the women demonstrating? So we got a comparison. Under conflict management, if there was a granular behavior to say that she listens to others when there is difference of opinion. So on a scale of 1 to 10, we said, how much of it she was doing right now? So they would say maybe 7. How much of it would you like them to be doing? So maybe 9. So that input we got from people, and when we got it, we found some great results. Unfortunately, my net is slow now. So let me just wait for a while. So with this input that we got, we started getting different inputs from them. If anybody has a question, you can ask me a question till the time we get the next slide going. Any questions so far, just type. Any question? Any question? Okay. So what we realized is, while this assessment that we did, and we did for 2,500 leaders, initially it was not meant to be studied. How can we thrive in a patriarchal world? Yeah, I understand what you're saying. We'll come to that. That is exactly what we are going to go through in this entire masterclass to some extent, and then maybe later as to how we need to do it. So while initially we were not focusing on the difference between men and women, but when we started compiling data, we found some interesting differences between the leadership competencies of men and women. And what we found was women were better in dash of the 19 EI capabilities. So there were 19 capabilities that we talked about. I wanted to guess how many capabilities do you think women were better in vis-a-vis men? Is it 8? Is it 12? Is it 15? Great. Some women really believe we are better in 15 out of. So who says we lack self-confidence? We don't. Yeah, we are completely confident. In fact, 17. Great. Yeah, massive self-confidence. So basically, self-confidence does not mean overly optimistic. Overly optimistic is not self-confidence. Any other number? Yeah, quickly. Who's coming up with a number? Yeah, anybody who's not taken it? Okay, let me share the results. 50% of us say 15. 50% of us say 12. The good news here is that 15 out of the 19 competencies women were better in, capabilities women were better. 15 of them. Now, which were the ones they were really good in? So out of the 15, there was a minor gap. So there were minor increase. We would not take the minor one, but we'll take the major differences. The major differences vis-a-vis men. Women scored better in service orientation, developing others, change catalyst, transparency, empathy, and inspirational leadership. So these are the six that women seem to be substantially better than men. Also, there were four of them. In Western, men scored better. Emotional self-control, self-confidence, accurate self-assessment, and adaptability. Now, why adaptability? That was slightly surprising for us. We realized that when women reached the top, they either became Margaret Thatcher, that means the Iron Lady, or they became too motherly. So women at high places normally are not able to adapt. They do not become assertive when they need to. They are too good. They are too kind. Or at times, because they don't want to be taken for a ride, they become too stiff and too strong. So they were not able to adapt based on environment. And I would actually give a little element of this because of self-confidence. Right? So these are four competencies women were not good at. Now let us see what can we learn from the strengths that women were good at. So as we said, there are six strengths that they were good at. What was not really surprising for us was service orientation, developing others, and empathy. Because in our years of coaching women leaders, I've coached almost around 18 women leaders till now, I have found that women are more caring and more helpful. And they really are able to think about the other person more than what men can. So this was not very surprising, though we found that at times they got confused between empathy and sympathy. So these three were not surprising. They came up with what we had seen. What was, however, surprising for us was change catalyst, inspirational leadership, and transparency, because it meant one thing. It meant, or it gave us an indication, that women were able to take better risk. Now, that was surprising, and we had to go deeper and drill down deeper to find out and try to make some sense of it. And when we went deeper down, seeing the data in more granular detail, we realized that women were better than men in being a change catalyst, because whenever there was a change that was required, they did not thrust that change on people, but they got them involved and they communicated better with people to enable that change. So what did they really do? They kind of interacted more. So they were able to take people along because their power of communication and showing the vision of what the change would do was able to enthuse people moving into that change. Another great thing that we saw is in terms of transparency. We found women by and large to be more honest than men. I'm so sorry, there's some issue with the net. Yeah, is breaking, right? I'll speak slightly slower. Okay, so what we found in transparency, women seem to be or are more honest than men. Also, we found in inspirational leadership, women by and large hold themselves accountable to what they say they will do. So what they found was they were able to inspire people because they were seen as more authentic. So these three things came up very easily for us. And let us now see what are the areas of development of women that we must focus on. So the strengths we got, we understood what it was. We realized they were true. We also realized why they were able to do so. Let us now dwell slightly on the areas of development. In the areas of development, as I said, there were four competencies they were not that good at. So also, when you do the workshop, we will break down these competencies to 12 habits. Because every competency in itself, if women is good in change catalyst, then how not adaptability? Yeah, adaptability is to do with adapting your leadership style. Change management or catalyst is getting other people to get involved. So they communicate well. Right, so they are in different context. They're slightly different context. So that's the reason why. Now coming to the habits. So now what we have done is out of these four behaviors that they are, or four capabilities that they are, we have broken them down to 12 habits. The four habits that I'm showing here are the four habits women should do better at. Firstly, they are reluctant to claim their own achievement. You tell a woman, well done. She says, no, sir, thank you so much. But actually, my team did it. Or I did not do it alone. So while that's a good thing to do, it is also a good thing to say thank you and accept a good thing. The second was they were expecting that people would notice their good work without them needing to talk about it. Please be clear, today in this world, you have to authentically and integrously show what you have done. And unless you do not show what you have done and talk about it, and not in a egoistic way, in a matter of fact way, people will tend not to notice you. Also, they overvalued expertise, overvalued the fact that they needed to be 100% sure of what they were doing before they could do it. And in this case, I'll just come to this. A Hewlett-Packard report, which was an internal report, said that men were able to apply for a job and a senior job, even if they felt they were 60% prepared. But women, unless they were sure that they were 100% prepared for the next level job, they would not be too excited about taking it. You ask a woman, are you ready to take the, hey, congratulations, I think we are wanting to, kind of promote you. And you say, 1 second. That's okay, but can you give me 3-4 months more for me to develop myself? So in some manner, women want to be perfect. And you can understand why it is. Across the world, everybody wants, has been wanting a woman to be a perfect wife, a perfect mother, a perfect daughter, a perfect everything. And they have put so much burden on the women that the women, unless she's 100% sure of herself, she does not claim what is her right. But women must realize that irrespective of what you do, you will always learn on the go and you will never be fully prepared for something. So take over that and start taking those. So here are some habits that I thought I would also talk about. Also, one more thing that we found was women had this disease to please. And please don't use these words against me, because these are words used by some people, and Marshall Goldsmith, he's again one of my mentors, in a book that he wrote along with the women. So to know what this disease to please is, we found that women at times cared too much about what people thought about them. In fact, I've also got a lot of experience when I coach women. A lot of women are too concerned about what people think about themselves. Pavan, if I change, what will my team say? And let's see a little video also on this to get to know what this disease to please really is.
With Sally Hodison, my great friend, lead author of our new book, How Women Rise. So excited about our book, aimed at helping women achieve higher levels of influence, authority, to make more of a positive difference in the world. One of the things that we talk about in the book is called The Disease to Please. Sally, share some of your ideas, and maybe I'll share a couple of mine.
Sounds good, Marshall. The disease to please is what we call it, and it's a tendency that many women have, and that I've watched for decades sabotage women, in which you feel that your success is judged on whether everybody else is happy, and that it's your job to make sure other people are happy.
I see.
Whether you're at work or whether you're at home, that's the burden you take on. One of the ways it can really sabotage you at work, and we've got a wonderful example in the book of a woman who was a hospital administrator, and she had moved up to ever higher position in the hospital. But a lot of patients and their families had come over the years to rely upon her. Mm-hmm. And as she moved to a higher level, that was no longer her job. But they kept saying, "We love working with Deborah. Can't Deborah help us on this?"
Right.
And she felt, because she wanted to make people happy in the world, and because she had a sense of real compassion for her patients and their families, that she had to keep helping them, even though that was no longer her job, and she was really burning herself out. So that's the disease to please, to some extent, run wild.
You know, it's a great example. And in my classes for women in leadership, I frequently bring up the issue of mothers who have 14-year-old kids. And what I tell them is, look, if you work full-time, the 14-year-olds are going to say, "You're a terrible mother because you're never at home." If you don't work, they're going to say, "You're a loser because you can't get a job." 14-year-old kids are not going to like anybody.
Exactly.
That's the way it works, right? And you can't get into this please them because it's hopeless. It's just not going to happen. So I think your point is very well taken. You can't please everybody all the time. And this can end up holding you back from your career rather than helping you.
Exactly.
Okay, great. So what we found was that women actually start taking too many people into consideration. And let me tell you, you can't please everybody. And you don't need to please everybody. In fact, Naomi, the Pepsi boss, also had a video which I saw a long time, and they said, and she said, "I've needed to make compromises in some relationships." And that's okay. If that is what you want. Again, let's not judge it. You can't hear me? You can't hear me now? I think you can hear me now. Neha, can you hear me? Prema is typing. Can you hear me now? Can, yeah. Thank you. Okay. So this is something that women need to work on. Also, how can women increase their self-confidence is something that we need to also ensure. So what we found was that one of the best ways of increasing self-confidence is take a 360 degree for yourself. What we have found is competent women, whenever they take a 360 degree, their own self-assessment of themselves seems to be much lesser than what people outside her colleagues actually talk about her and tell her about. So the fact that you get that input from people is the first step for women to realize that they are better than what they think they are. In addition to this, what we also believe is that women need coaching and mentoring. So for any development to take place, you need to be coached and mentored either within your organization with some senior men leaders so that you build up your confidence by having those dialogues or by external coach, but you do need, or women do need, some support in building their self-confidence, because to do it alone may be more difficult than easy. The third thing that we realized was they also at times minimize what they have done. There are some words that we keep hearing from women time and again. They say things like, this will only take, so if they come to me, this will just take me 5 minutes. Can I come in? You might not agree with this, but it might not be a good idea. Before you even give your idea, you're qualifying it by saying it's not a good idea. I just have one thing to say. I want to make a small point. So we find women, by their body language and by the words that they use, minimize themselves and show a reduced self-confidence. So women need to be slightly more aware of the words that you are using. Any idea that you are giving, small or big, does not need to be qualified as such. And what women are also doing, they are also preparing themselves for people not accepting that idea. It is a small idea. No, no, this is not good enough. Okay, okay. Because it was small, right? So you're preparing yourself for that. So women should be able to hold this space with self-confidence, both in their body language. In fact, very interestingly, I was doing a workshop the other day, and there were five people who came late. So there was some kind of a roadblock, and I'm talking about 3 months back. So there were five or six women in that room. There were also men in this room. And there were empty chairs in each of the tables. The moment these five people came in, I found the men suddenly putting their hands on the chairs which were unoccupied but near them, as if giving an indication to these people that please don't come here. And I found women offering automatically. They became smaller, right? And they automatically started giving an input that the chair next to me is available. Why don't you come here? So while that may not be in itself a big thing, in fact, I thought it was a very good gesture from the part of the women. But this is the kind of body language that women do even in places they don't need to do. Okay, having understood this, we also must understand one thing, that women do not need to be an alpha male woman. So if I want to really grow as a leader, I do not need to take role models of those obnoxious alpha male who by their body language and by the way they talk are seen as arrogant. So women don't need to be arrogant. Women need to be who they are. They need to be comfortable in being the human being that they are. Because in itself, you are good enough and you don't need to follow a model which is not required anymore. In fact, women need to open up more to show their vulnerability. Because the moment you show your vulnerability and you can get that capability to say, I don't know and I like to discuss it with you how to do it, you find people are move up out of the comfort zone and come out of it to be able to collaborate and discuss things. So women, you are good as you are. You do not need to be the alpha male type. You need to be just yourself. And also be confident in the fact, and that's where accurate self-assessment comes, that every human being has got some strengths and some areas they are not good at. And you are not alone in it. So you have to accept who you are. You also have to be acknowledging what you cannot do that well, so that whenever you get something to do which requires that skill, you can reach out and get a person who's required in that. Okay, so with that also, let's see what support must women be provided. In fact, tomorrow I'm doing a workshop, Triggers. And one of the big lessons in it is that in spite of us believing we can change all by ourselves, the fact of life is that there are too many triggers around us which prevent us from making the changes that we require. In fact, if you just look back, think of one change that you have tried to make all these years, but you have not been able to do so. You will find a lot of things that you have not been able to change by yourself, because you believe in one myth that I can do it myself. The first thing about any change is to realize and being able to say, I'm Pawan Bakshi, I'm not good in making relationship and doing small talks with people in parties. I've been trying to change for so many years and have failed. I now know I can't do it alone. I need help, and that is okay. So to accept the fact that the change, if it is supported, is more likely to happen, we are then going to open ourselves to those changes. And a few things that we suggest is that the first thing women must understand is what this new effective leadership model is all about and how this effective new leadership model connects with emotional intelligence. How emotional intelligence and leadership, both of them, when connected and when demonstrated, truly bring out a leader who is the need of today. So that understanding you must have. The third understanding you must have is you need to be able to accurately conduct an assessment about yourself, where you are able to identify what your strengths are and which specific areas of development you need to focus on and which will have the greatest impact in your present role. And this role I'm talking about is your personal role and professional role. Because the fact is, we can't change everything at once. There are some high impact changes which are likely to have a greater impact in my life than low impact changes which might not materially change my life. So I need to identify those areas which will make that big difference in my life as I exist today. Also, women leaders need to understand and practice a number of tools and techniques to build their self-confidence. The self-talk that women have, and also a lot of men have. So I'm not saying that men don't have it, some men don't have it. Yet we are only focusing on the competencies that we talked about. So that self-talk, how can we put it positive to ourselves and how can we demonstrate this to the world around? Also, we must understand, because one more area that we thought we saw that women were not good at, they were good at emotional self-awareness, meaning they understood what they were feeling. But in critical situations, in crisis, when things were not going right and tempers were flayed, we found that women were not able to control their emotions much. So women must know techniques and tools which they can apply at the right time to be able to have manage themselves better, be able to control themselves in a better way. Also, what women need to do is they need to understand that there are 6 emotional intelligent leadership styles and which style needs to be used with which person and in which situation so as to the fact that they can be adaptable. They must understand that they need commanding style at certain point in time, but they also need to move into a coaching style if so required. And they don't have 1 or 2 fixed styles. Based on their past, you create 1 or 2 fixed styles of leadership. Either you become a commanding and pace setting. That's the one we talked about, Margaret Thatcher, right? They already wear multiple hats at the same time, but here I'm talking about different leadership styles. Wearing hats, they're very good at that. Because the brain of the women, it can multitask better. They can be a mother, but when situations come in your professional life, how can you change and adapt to that style? Also, what people need to understand is that need to know that they have some strengths, which is unique. And this unique strength of theirs can be used in creating a culture within the organization, which is performance enhanced. So with these 7 elements, women, and with the coaching support and mentoring support, women can truly get better. And women need that support in organization. We spend so much time on building a leadership pipeline. Everybody talks about a leadership pipeline. Nobody or very few organizations talk about building a women leader pipeline. So the key takeaway that I like you to take from this is the role of women, how well we do as an organization in the 21st century, is going to be a function of whether we allow women to take their rightful role in our organization. If we do not do that, and we do not allow this women to come in and bring in their diversity, our organizations are not going to do better. Also, we have to ensure, as a key takeaway, we are not doing anybody a favor by getting a, by talking about diversity. Diversity is not the issue at all. It is the different mindsets, different attitudes, different perceptions which women get, which strengthen the organization. That is the key reason why women need to be there. It is not only for the sake of diversity. And finally, we should provide them workshops and coaching so that they can build up a strong pipeline of leaders who through the next 10 to 12 years keep growing and bringing their strengths into force. More and more companies now recognize that collaborative rather than competitive behavior creates more success. And as such, women are well placed to lead in this sector. So that brings me to the end of this little masterclass that we had. Thank you so much for it. So best of luck. Have a great time. Enjoy yourselves. You women are wonderful. You are doing a great job. Just focus on areas that you need to get better at. And I can tell you, you are doing us men and our company is a great favor when you step up to being the best that you are. And we need you. Thank you so much. Have a great time. God bless. Thank you so much.